sincere prayer that God would just do something mighty in your life to reveal to you His grace, His love, and His power. And in that, may we grow stronger in our relationship with Him. And so with that being said, let's look at this call to worship verse of Scripture from Psalm 66. He says, read with me, "Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Your enemies cringe before your mighty power. Everything on earth will worship you. They will sing your praises, shout your name in glorious song." So let us truly say how awesome our God's deeds are in our lives, and how that we know that even our enemies, and I don't want you to think about a person, I want you to think about our real enemy, the enemy that seeks to and fro like a roaring lion seeking in whom he might devour, from last week's sermon. But let's think about that real enemy, the Satan that and the demons that are always chasing us and throwing temptations in our lives. And maybe you've given in to some of those temptations, but God's power is greater than that. And that's why we want to worship Him this day, so that we might all be drawn closer to Him and singing His wonderful praises. Jeremy?
Good morning, everyone. I want you to know how blessed I feel to be able to be here in God's house worshiping with y'all today, if you would. Bow your heads and we'll pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this blessed day that we can all come together and worship as a family, Lord. Lord, thank you for all the other blessings you give us, our families, our homes, our jobs, and the chance to share your word and love with others, Lord. Lord, please open our ears and our hearts today as Daniel gives this message, that we may accept these words and carry them out into the community and share them with others, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's remain standing for worship as we begin to sing, "Blessed Be Your Name."
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name in the found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose. voice to sing. Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
In Christ alone.
Till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
Amen. Beautiful singing. You may be seated.
Wow, I love that song. It's got just such a powerful message in it. You know, and one of the beautiful things about that song is it takes us all the way through what happened at the cross. You know, and there he says, till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. You see, there's so much, it's just so much truth in just that one part of this stanza. Till he returns. Folks, God's not through with us yet. And he's not through with us because there's still breath in your body. And then also, God has not sent Jesus back yet for us. He says, or calls me home here in the power. Folks, it's only in the power of God in which we're able to face life and overcome so much that this world is throwing at us, particularly at this time in history. And he says, in the power of Christ, I'll stand. He didn't say, in the power of Christ, I'll sit down. In the power of Christ, I'll lay down. In the power of Christ, I'll quit and give up. But he says, I'll stand. And folks, I just want to remind you, we will never be able to stand in the power of Christ until we're on our knees before God. That's the importance of prayer. And that's why we always pause during this time on Sunday mornings, just to give you an opportunity to pray, because truth be known, life is busy. And you can get so busy, you forget to pray. Or life can be going so good that you don't see a need to pray. Either one is wrong. We need to always be in a constant mode of prayer. And so to renew our commitment to prayer, to be able to stand in this time and experience God's power, let's once again go boldly before his throne of grace, and lifting our hearts to him, praying for ourselves and for one another. Let's pray together. Oh, Father God, we come before you, Lord, with hearts of thanksgiving. God, praising you for who you are, and God, for all that you have done. Lord, from the very beginning of time to, Lord, what you're going to do at the very end of time. And God, for what you're doing right here in the midst of our time. God, we come, Lord, once again, just devoting ourselves to you. Father, reminding ourselves, Lord, who we are, and Lord, who you are. And Father, we just want to thank you, God, that your grace is always sufficient, and that, Lord, that your power, Lord, is the greatest. And God, remind ourselves, Lord, of just how weak we really are. But God, as we have come to learn, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And so God, on ourselves, Lord, as we come before you right now, Lord, with bowed heads, Lord, representing that of a bowed heart, God, we come, Lord, asking, Father, for your strength and, Lord, for your power to reign in our lives. Lord, over sin, over temptations, God, over failures. But Lord, also to be able to give us the power, God, to face tomorrow. And Lord, the challenges in which it presents, Father, as we live through today. God, give us the boldness to be a witness for you, sharing, God, your good news, Lord, about your grace, your love, your mercy. Lord, the escape from your judgment. Lord, with everybody we come in contact with. And God, it's my prayer that this day, that Lord, that those who feel so helpless and so powerless, God, would come to renew their faith in you Strengthen them this day, God, is my prayer. Father, that people's hearts and lives would be changed. Father, that families, Lord, would be healed. And that, Father, that we as a church might be able to go boldly forth and proclaiming Jesus saves. Father, our desire is to make Christ known right here in Berea and beyond. Lord, you show us how to do that. And we'll be faithful, God, to follow through. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's continue our worship by the singing of Hallelujah. What a Savior. Starting on that second verse, let's sing together.
Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Guilty, vile, and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high, hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransom home to bring, then anew his song will sing, hallelujah. Savior.
Amen. When peace like a river attendeth my way, it is well with my soul. Would you stand as we sing?
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall be set. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Elsie. A proper perspective. Boy, that just has a way of just changing everything, doesn't it? Whenever you have a proper perspective on things, on people, on places, and even problems. And today we're going to conclude the book of 1 Peter. And we're going to put all these things into perspective. Let me share a quote to you about perspective. It was once said, if we all threw our problems into a pile and saw everyone else's, we'd grab ours back. Would you not? For you see, so often what ends up happening is that whenever problems happen to us, we get to where we feel like that we're the only one in the world that has that problem. Another thought for us to consider is perspective. It's the way we see things when we look at them from a certain distance, and it allows us to appreciate their true value. So I want to encourage you to silence your cell phones this morning because of the perspective that God's going to speak, and I don't want you being distracted. But 1 Peter chapter 5, let me take this back to a perspective, okay? And let's remember who this letter was for, who wrote this letter, and where they were during this time of their lives. You see, the church had had some victories, but they were still under the Roman authority and even persecution. But because of Nero coming into power, he hated the Christians. He only wanted just what he could milk out of them, their taxes, but he could not stand them. And so therefore, he made their lives very difficult. And persecution began to come on them. And the ones who were deciding and making a bold statement in their lives that they were going to be followers of Christ, they were the recipients of the worst kinds of persecution from the government. Many were arrested. Many were put to death. Many were, as we've already talked about in previous weeks, were fed to lions as part of a game. Some were impaled on sticks and their bodies coated in tar and caught on fire at night to light the emperor's garden. Sick, sadistic things happened to them. But not only did we see that there was this persecution coming from the government, but they also experienced the persecution of loneliness because they were ostracized by their fellow Jews who would not accept Christ as being the Savior of the world, God's only begotten Son. And so therefore, they were ostracized from their own families. Many of these people had businesses, and some of their most loyal customers would not trade with them anymore because they professed to be these Christ followers. And because of all this, they begin to scatter out. And they begin to move out from where they were. And it was only because of the persecution in which they were experiencing that the church began to truly scatter. And even in AD 70, whenever Nero burnt Rome and blamed the Christians for it, and many of them were executed whenever they had nothing to do with it, it really just set a fire under the Christians to even be more bold in their faith. But then we see where the church is now scattered. And the church is still under persecution. And Peter writes a letter to those scattered church members that were under persecution. And he gives them instructions on how now you shall live. And that's what we've looked at in 1 Peter. And we come down to this, and I'm going to read the text, and then we're going to look at it going backwards this morning. If you look here in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 10 through 14, these last four verses of this chapter, of this text, he said, in his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. All power to him forever. Amen. I have written and sent this short letter to you with the help of Silas, whom I have commended to you as a faithful brother. My purpose in writing is to encourage you and assure that what you are experiencing is truly part of God's grace for you. Stand firm in this grace. Your sister church here in Babylon sends you greetings, and so does my son Mark. Greet each other with a holy kiss. Peace be with you all who are in Christ. Let's pray. Father, you know, Lord, the message that needs to be delivered this morning. Father, it's not what I want to say, but God, what I know that you need to say. And so, God, once again, I, as your humble servant, Father, just ask, Lord, you move me out of the way, and Lord, you speak. And Father, that you may be lifted up. Because, God, in our own ways, so many of us are facing persecution. Father, it pales in comparison, God, to what our brothers and sisters around the world right now are facing. But, Lord, still right now, whenever we see liberalism, Father, just taking over our nation and ungodliness being celebrated, and, Father, Christian values and morals and decency, Father, is being squished. Father, up from the ashes, God, may you bring your glory. And Father, may we be the ones to do so. So, Father, use us during this time, Father, to be your instruments, Father, of hope and, Lord, of power in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Peter was with a man by the name of Silas. And he says, I have written and sent this short letter to you with the help of Silas. Now let me explain what is going on here. Silas was an amanuensis where he was Paul's secretary, Peter's secretary, in whom this letter has been dictated, and Silas was very busy writing it down as Peter was giving it to him. But Peter comes to the end of this letter, and instead of just signing it off, he takes, in my mind, I see where he takes the quill from that of Silas's hands, and he dips it into the ink, and he writes out these last words himself. And that's why he says, I have written and sent this short letter. And I know some of you are thinking, yeah, it's a short letter, but preacher, you sure have done a good job of keeping it a long time and everything. Some of us are just very talented in being able to make a short story long. But I don't want you to leave not missing any of the good stuff that Peter has had to say to that church that could be applied to us this day. And he says to you with the help of Silas. Now let's go back just for a moment and let's explore who Silas was. A lot of times we don't really know who some of these people are, but Silas, and I know that some of your Bibles may say Silvanus, but that's just another name for Silas. Silas was a man who was persecuted for his faith, for he was also put in prison with Paul. You remember they were singing together one night, Paul and Silas, and the jails came open and they were freed. But Silas knew about this great pain of persecution. He had had his feet put in stocks. He had had his back beaten with whips. He had been put in prison, and he had lost so much of his livelihood. I cannot help but to think that as Peter was writing these, as Peter was saying these things, and as Silas was writing them, it's kind of like whenever Michael leads us to sing a song. And as those songs in that moment of worship just kind of ministers to us to where we might have to lift a hand to God. We might have to stand there with our eyes closed as we think about what those words are saying to us in that song. It may even cause us even just to cry out, yes, Lord, in the middle of a song because it just touches our soul. And so many of those songs a while ago were doing to my soul, and especially the songs, It Is Well. 30 years ago today, Our nation was involved in a war called Desert Storm. I was there. And I tell you, that song, It Is Well, was one that really made it strong in my heart, because none of us were guaranteed we were going to come home alive. But before I left, I made sure that it was well with my soul. And a lot of other people did. But mine was already in the process, and mine was just another step. Some, it was the beginning step. Some did it because they feared death, but they live far from God today. But Silas was one that had gone through the war. And as Peter was saying these words, his heart was resonating with everything that he was saying. And no doubt he was probably saying, yes, Lord, yes. Because see, what happens is that whenever we have trials in life, if we do not put them in the proper perspective, we will run from God instead of to God. And he says, whom I commend to you as a faithful brother. You know, the true faithfulness will not be measured in how well you attended church. Your real faithfulness will not be measured in just how good of a person you were. Your real faithfulness will be measured in how you were able to overcome the trials, the temptations, the heartaches, and even the persecutions in life. That is the measure of faithfulness that Peter is speaking about with Silas, and knowing all that he had gone through, and he maintained to be a faithful brother. And he says, my purpose in writing is to encourage you and assure you that what you are experiencing is truly part of God's grace for you. So we look at that and we say, So you mean to tell me that all this stuff that I'm going through is there to encourage me? Folks, you'll never really know exactly how powerful God is until you have to lean on all of God's power. You will never experience the depths of God's grace until you realize the heinousness of your sin, and only Jesus Christ can forgive you of those sins. You will never understand the power of God's presence until you don't have nobody else except for God with you. And so, yes, he's writing all these things so that we might be able to be encouraged and to assure you that what you're experiencing is truly part of God's grace for you. Now, let me explain something to you about this. Sometimes some of the stuff in which we go through is because of our own stupidity and our own hardness of heart, and because of our own sinful ways. So you're going through it because of God's judgment. But let me tell you, even as part of God's judgment, it is still there to show you God's grace. Because let me tell you, listen to me, no one is able to stand in God's judgment. But by God's grace, he is able to forgive us of our sins whenever we confess them, whenever we turn from our wicked ways, when we repent from those things that are ungodly and impure and unholy, and we begin to turn towards God, then what ends up happening is that we're able to experience God's grace. So no matter if the things in your life are happening because you're going through life on earth, or because of your own sinfulness, either way is going to be meant for you to experience God's grace. So he tells us, stand firm in this grace. Once again, even like the song that Michael had to sing a while ago about, to be able to stand. He wants us to stand firm in this grace. And this is where we go back and we look at what he is saying here. And that is that he is saying, let me back up just a moment. He's telling them to stand firm in this grace, and that's why he also says, your sister church here in Babylon sends you greetings. Now, understand that this was probably not exactly Babylon as we know in the Old Testament, which is part of Iraq today. He probably was speaking about where he was writing from as a code to those people that were going to be reading this letter. And what he was saying was that if we can stand here in this Babylon, then you can stand where you are. And folks, I just want to just encourage you that no matter how bad things are here, it's nowhere near as bad as what it is in other places. Perspective. If we took all of our problems and threw them into a pile, you'll be glad to take up your own and go back home with them, you know? So he's throwing out to remind them from where he is writing this from. And he says, and so does my son Mark. This is not literally his son. He's referring to Mark, who actually wrote the Gospel of Mark. He's referring to him as a son or a brother in the faith. And he says, greet each other with a kiss of love. Now, we've already discussed this a few weeks ago. And that is, if you got more facial hair than me, don't you pucker up near me. Okay? Yeah. But we're not going to override our cultural norms here to be able to implement that into something that is not normal here for us. But men greeted men with a kiss on the cheek. Women greeted women with a kiss on the cheek. And today in our society, what we have come to is to where it would be what we used to do, shake hands. You know, now we're elbow bumping, fist bumping. It's still kind of awkward, you know. Somebody stick out their hand, or I stick out my hand, and you still see that moment of hesitancy, like, do I not, you know? Or somebody stick out their hand, and somebody stick out their fist, you know? So you change, and they change, you know? It's like, okay, hey! So you just wave. What he's doing here is he's saying, we've all been through this. So you can greet each other. And we can say, we know what you're going through. And he says, peace be with you all who are where? In Christ. So therefore, if you want the peace, you've got to be in Christ. And so let the trials turn you towards Christ, not away from Christ, in order to experience his peace. And then this is where he says in verse 10 and 11, he said, in his kindness, God. Now, this is what the New Living Translation says, but let me go back to what some other translations say, and it says, the God of all grace. I love that. The God of all grace called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will give you a place on a firm foundation. Here again, the picture to stand. All power to him forever. Amen. And so, you know, gaining the proper perspective is what our greatest goal is got to be. You got to get a perspective on it. Now, let me talk to us just a little bit about this perspective. And that is that whenever you are a part of an organization, it can be a school, it can be an industry, it can be a business, it can even be a family. You are connected into something that is bigger than what you are. Okay? Now, from that, what we have to do is not just look at ourselves, but try to gain a better perspective of things. Now, see, this is what often separates the followers from the leaders. And in this day and time, we hear so much about being a leader, being a leader, being a leader. And very little is ever said about ever being a good follower. But let me tell you this, though. You cannot be a leader until you are first a follower. And you cannot be a good leader unless you were first a good follower. So therefore, if we're going to look into our lives and want to be in the lead, if we need to take perspective, not just because you want to, but because it's going to be thrust upon you, then you better learn how to lead. You better learn how to follow today. It's kind of like this. And that is that you are a part of a business, and the owner is not always there, but he has a manager. And the manager has to leave, but the business must go on. So somebody has got to step up and take control and make some decisions. And what are you going to do if they turn around and say, hey, I got to leave, you're in charge? Now, a couple different things are going to happen. One is you're going to look at it and say, well, it's about time, because I'm fixing to make some changes around here I've been wanting to make. We've all worked for people like that, right? That power just, boom, blows their head up. Another thing is that you might do is might say, oh, wait, no, I didn't sign on for that. Being in charge is above my pay grade. I ain't doing it. I ain't making those decisions. I'm just happy showing up here from 9 to 5 and drawing a paycheck. I don't want any of the other responsibilities. And then there's another perspective to it. God, I didn't choose to be put in this leadership position, but you chose me. And I know I can't, but you can. And you gladly accept that position humbly before God, even if it's just for an hour or for a day or for a season of your life. And let me bring this closer into home, okay? And that is that when you become a parent, you become a leader. And one of the jobs as a parent, you are to lead. And yes, I am from not the old school, I'm from the Bible school. Men are to be the leaders of their homes. Point blank, period. If you want to argue with me about that, bring your Bible on. And we're going to have a Bible study. Now, that does not mean that the man has to rule with an iron fist. It just means that the buck ought to stop with him. And another thing is that whenever a man stands in judgment, he will stand on how well he led his own home. Now, from that though, what we've got to understand is the reason that you're the leader over your family is because you have now reached an age where you can have children. So hopefully in those years, you've learned a thing or two. Instead of just partying and wasting your life away, have you learned any life lessons that have prepared you for that moment for parenthood or even grandparenthood? Okay, now stay with me on this right here. And that is that when a little child comes to you and wants to do something that you know that is unsafe, and you say no, are you being cruel and mean to that child? Why do you do that? Because you love that child? You say no? Is it because you want to protect that child that you say no? So it's not punishment. It's because, listen to me, you have a better perspective on it than what the child does. And the problem is, in this day and time, too many children are running the households. Now, you have the position, not just the title, but you have the position. Now, it's kind of like this right here. A child is wanting to reach up onto the stove and grab the handle of a pot that is up there. So what do you do? No. And I know that I've got the voice of a drill sergeant, and I have to remind myself that when I'm speaking to my grandchildren, but when I see something that's about to cause them harm, oh yeah, I can strike fear into them with my voice. I can, you know, I can catch their attention because it is not up for debate as to whether or not, well, don't do that. You know, I know y'all just love it when grandparents tell stories about their grandchildren, but I know a certain pappy that has a little 18-month-old grandson, and he learns no. Like recently, I was sitting there with him, and he reached over to grab the remote controls, and he looked at me as he was reaching, and I'm like, no, 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 and he reaches over, and he picks it up. Finally, I look at him, and says, I said no. He put it down. Why? Because that little snot has learned how to throw things in the trash can, and we've dug a lot of remote controls and everything else out of the trash can. Okay? It's not that I'm scared he's going to destroy it. It's just that you try to find it after he's left. Like, I know that remote's around here somewhere, and we've gone digging through the trash can. All right. But if he was reaching up to grab a hold of a pot on the stove, I'm not going to start off with saying, no, no. I'm going to get his attention right away. Why? Because I have a different perspective than him. My perspective is the fact that I'm 6 foot tall. I can see what's up there. He can't. I'm going to use my perspective to protect my grandchild. I'm also going to use the perspective that I'm 54 years old and he's only 18 months old. I know what hot is. He doesn't really know what hot is. I'm also going to use my perspective that I've seen burnt children before, and I do not want him burnt. So you see, I'm going to gather up all these perspectives, and in a moment, I'm not going to have a debate with myself saying, well, I can see because I'm taller than him, I'm older than him, so therefore I should tell him not to. You know, and I've seen the horrors of a burnt child before, and so, you know, I'm just not really sure. What has happened in that amount of time while you're debating with yourself? The child gets burned. So folks, I'm telling you, we need to go through life and looking at perspective so that we might be able to help protect other people. That's why sometimes God allows us to go through some things so that then we can take our testimony and turn it over and use it as a perspective to try to help someone else. So what we do is we got to gain a proper perspective. First off is we got to learn who God is. You got to get a proper perspective of God. Here he says, God of all grace. The God in his loving kindness. And you see, and if you do not have a proper perspective on who God is, you'll never have a proper perspective on anything in life. Why? Because he is the one that is the designer of life. He is the one that is the giver of life. And he is also the one that is the taker of life. So therefore, what we've got to do, first off, above all things, is get a proper perspective of who God is. Now, can you get a proper perspective on God away from God? No. You will get a very distorted perspective of God because what you will do is you will fall for whatever you hear man say. You know, if we're not reading the Bible, but we're reading everything else, then we will fall for whatever the world is shoveling down our throats. If you are willing to attend anything else where it's entertainment, or even if it's educational, but you never attend church or anything else where you might learn about God, you'll believe anything that they're going to tell you. If you will listen to only music that glorifies self and flesh and sin, and every once in a while they might sprinkle in something about God in there, then you might even fall for that. That's okay. Without ever singing the hymns, without ever singing the spiritual songs, without ever attending church, without ever saying your prayers, without ever being around fellow Christians, without ever reading the Bible, you will never, ever have a proper perspective on who God is. And he's to be worshiped, and he's also to be feared. And so therefore, the first thing to do is get a perspective on who God is. But you spend a lifetime learning that so that whenever the hard times come, you've got something to fall back on. You got something to be able to stand on. The next thing you got to get a proper perspective on is God's calling. You see, here he says, he called you to share. Now understand about this, and that is that first off, our salvation comes as a result of God calling us unto his salvation. Jesus said, unless the Father calls them, no one can come unto me. So what you've got to do is look at God, the perspective of God's calling. First off is to understand God's calling for you unto salvation. You see, you don't go after God. God has already come after you. You don't go calling God. You answer God because he called you first. You don't start loving God in order to try to get God to love you because God already loved you first. So what we do is we've got to look at this calling first off for our salvation. And my question to you is, have you answered God's calling unto your salvation? And if you haven't, then what you got to do is just stop and turn to him and say, God, I want my life to glorify you. And being lost out in this world and living in sin, I can't glorify you. So God, I want to repent of all of my sins. I want your forgiveness. I want you to take my soul and save it, but I want you to take my life and I want to give it all to you. And in God's calling into salvation then leads his calling into the purpose of your life. Now, this is a question that I get asked a lot, and I'm going to go to this here just in a moment, but also finding your purpose. But I want to tell you, God called his son Jesus to be the Savior of the world. And Jesus answered that call, and he came into this world, and he is the Savior of the world. But he had to go through all of the stuff that led to his crucifixion in order to have the victory of a resurrection. God might be leading you through some very difficult times so that you can have the victory of, just like whenever he called forth his son back from the dead, he calls you out of all of that. So listen to the calling. And then the proper perspective of the trial itself. He says, for a little while. Now I want you to understand this. For a little while. The Christians had been going through a persecution for quite some time. And he tells them, it's just for a little while. It's just for a little while. You know, nothing except for heaven lasts forever. Heaven and hell are the only two things that are going to last forever. Your life is not going to last forever. Multiple times in the Bible, he compares our life to like that of a dew or a fog or a mist. It's here for a little while and then it's gone. You know, it's compared to like that of flowers or grass. It's here for a little while and it's gone. So whatever trials in which you may be going through your life right now with, it may seem like it's been going on for a long time, but it's really just for a little while. Because God did not make us just for the life here on earth, but he's made us for all eternity. He's made us for eternity, folks. And so I know that whatever it is that you might be going through right now, it may seem like that it is lasting forever. Because it's consuming you, it's always in your thoughts, it's always in your mind, your heart is breaking, you're concerned, you're worried, but just hang on. I had a pastor friend of mine who he and I only saw each other once a year, and every time that I'd see him, he'd always ask me the same question, Daniel, how's it going? And I always had a stock answer. And that was, it's going great. Or, it's not going so good. And his reply was always the same. If I said, things are going great, he'd always say, don't worry, it'll change, it'll get bad. But he was speaking the truth. And if I were to tell him, things aren't going so good right now, he'd always say, don't worry, it'll change, it's going to get better. And it always did. So no matter where you are right now, understand that whatever you're going through, it's really just for a little while. You thought that high school was going to last forever, and it didn't. You thought that raising kids was going to last forever, but it didn't. You thought that maybe a bad job that you couldn't wait to get out of was going to last forever, but it didn't. And I could go through this on and on and on. But God doesn't want us to rush through those times, because in those times, in that little while, he's wanting to teach us some very valuable lessons. And sometimes those lessons are really about how to help other people more so than what it is to help ourselves. The fourth perspective is the purpose. And that is, a lot of people come to me and ask about, what's the purpose of my life? Well, the short answer is to bring God glory. But what's my purpose in this situation? To grow closer to God, to trust him. And I'm not giving those as flippant answers. I'm giving you those answers because until we get the proper perspective of God, and it's our job to bring him glory, and to answer the call in which he has given to us, to know that whatever he's putting us through, he's only preparing us for future and for better ministry. And look at the trial itself and realize this: what doesn't kill me only makes me stronger. And so whenever we look about this, we look at what the purpose is. He says he will restore. Let's just look at this right here just for a moment. Something cannot be restored until it's been torn down. Whenever God tears us down, it's actually he is humbling us so that then he might be able to restore us, build us up better than what we were before. Support. You will never learn how to lean on God until you have moments in your life where you have to lean on the everlasting arms. So sometimes God puts us through times just to be able to show us that he will restore and he will support us, and then to strengthen us. Because I said a while ago, what doesn't kill you will make you stronger. Well, the strength here is not physically as much as what it is spiritually. You'll never know how much strength you have until it's been tested. Everything has its testing points. And he will place you on a firm foundation. And you know who he places us on? The solid rock. Jesus Christ. Now, I want to share a very disturbing story with you. And I debated, even a while ago, sitting down here and while Elsie was singing, I was like, Lord, should I share this? And it's like, yeah. Because I don't know who this is meant for, but we don't like talking about God in these realms of when God allows bad things to happen to good people. But I want you to hear this story, a true story about a medical missionary that was serving in Central Africa by the name of Elizabeth Hansen. She had served the Lord faithfully for years when she answered the call to go be a missionary. The story goes that a rebellion broke out in the country, and one night the rebels broke into her house, went into her room, and violently raped her on a dirt floor. As it was taking place, she says, she cried out to God, Why are you allowing this to happen to me, God? In an almost audible voice, the Lord replied, when you choose to follow me, you gave me not only your mind and heart, but your body. They aren't just doing this to you, but to me. I am with you. You see, we would rather hear the story where the rebels broke in and mighty angels of God came and protected this young lady and slew them all with a breath, and villagers saw them and they became great fear of God and they all followed God. That's the story we like to hear. But that's not what happened. She goes on to say, I did not share this story very often, but years later, while in the U.S., I was lecturing on a technical medical subject when the Holy Spirit fell over me and convinced me that I was to tell my story. I didn't want to, but afterwards, I'm glad I did. You see, afterwards, everyone left except for two young girls. The older girl came up and said, your story? That's my 13-year-old sister. 2 months ago, she was raped in the park, and she hasn't spoken since. Elizabeth, the missionary's eyes and those of the young girl met and immediately filled with tears. They embraced, wept, and talked for over 2 hours. Elizabeth led her to Jesus Christ in those conversations. And today that girl is serving Christ today because Elizabeth Hansen grew solid through her suffering and let God use her painful experience to minister to others. Suffering is never easy, folks. And in the moment, we may not understand, God, why are you allowing this to happen to me? Why am I having to go through this? Why is my family having to go through this? But if you hang on and you turn it around and you give God the glory and you learn the lessons and you gain a different perspective for it, then what you'll find is that somewhere else, someone else has got a similar story, and God will use you to be able to help bring them through and point them to Jesus. Because I guarantee you, sometime in your life, perhaps you've gone through a difficult time, and somebody else that had a similar story somewhere else encouraged you and strengthened you to be able to have a different perspective. And it all begins right here, and that is for you to turn your eyes upon Jesus. And that is that no matter what you might be going through, keep your eyes on Jesus. And if you need help and turning your eyes towards Jesus, that's what the church is for. That's what I'm here as your pastor for. This is what our brothers and sisters in this local body of believers are here for, to help one another turn our eyes upon Jesus. Let's stand together as Brother Michael leads us in this hymn of invitation. And if you know that God has spoken to your heart and you need somebody to pray with you, pray for you, the altar is open, and I'll certainly meet you outside on the parking lot immediately after the services. Brother Michael.
There's light for all, look at the same.
Hey, as we get ready to leave out of here, don't let the sermon stop here. You take it and you live by it, but be willing to share your struggles with somebody else and also lend strength to somebody else that's going through struggles. Thank you for being here today. I just want to just encourage you to read your beacon. We've got some important announcements coming up in the next couple of weeks. And then also, next Sunday morning, we're restarting Sunday school life groups. And we're going to have sausage biscuits here next Sunday morning. And Suzanne, is that all right? We're going to have some sausage biscuits here next Sunday morning before Sunday school. It starts at 9:15. We'll have them in the Welcome Center starting at 8:45. Come on, grab a biscuit, grab some coffee, and then adults, you're going to be in this back hallway right back here of the Child Development Center, and look forward to seeing you then. Wear a mask if you like to, and just be here for the time of Bible study and fellowship. Let's go out of here with these simple words from 1 Peter 5:14. Peace be with all of you who are in Christ. And all of God's people said, amen.